Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Pereira. In the first 6 months of the current financial year, the country's fiscal deficit touched 91.3% of the full-year budget estimate as compared to 83.9% during the same period in the previous fiscal year. Data released by the CAG showed on Tuesday. Deficit, which reflects the excess of expenditure over revenues, was at 4.99 lakh crore rupees in absolute terms during the April-September period. There are concerns on whether the government will be able to stick to target of reducing the fiscal deficit to 3.2% of the gross domestic product by March end 2018. The data revealed that total expenditure during April-September period was 11.49 lakh rupees crore rupees, or at 53.5% of the entire fiscal's estimate. The revenue deficit during the period under review was over 3.8 lakh crore rupees, or almost 92% of the estimates. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze the growth aspirations versus fiscal health. Joining me on the program today are Dhirendra Kumar, Head Value Research, Subhomoy Bhattacharya, Consulting Editor of the Business Standard, and Nitin Desai, former Chief Economic Advisor to the Government of India. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Dhirendra Kumar, I'd like to begin with you, of course. What do these latest figures indicate?
They clearly indicate that, you know, what the government intended to. You know, if you look at the advancing of the budget and by a month, and basically, because after the budget, the various respective departments used to get little time. And that part, I think, you know, there is nothing unusual about it. It seems to be well on track. That was the intention. The delay in budget and then allocation to different ministries, then they start drawing their plans. Looks like, you know, the spending plan is getting more streamlined.
Okay. Mr. Desai, I'd like to bring you into the picture now. Do you believe that the fiscal deficit target will be met?
I don't think I would worry too much about the numbers that you mentioned. I'll tell you why. Because this year, the budget was passed earlier. Mm. There's been a certain amount of front-loading of expenditure. So the difference of 83% and 91% relative to 80% is not very alarming. Second, it is always the case that the revenue mobilization comes towards the latter part of the year. That's when the money comes in. So I would say that at this point, if you ask me, I'd say I don't see any reason for not accepting that the 3.2% be reached. In fact, there are other things which are, for instance, I think the divestment proceeds maybe even better with the way this stock market is going crazy. I think it's very likely that the divestment proceeds may be even better than what the budget allowed for. Warning signal is some hardening of the international oil price, which has started hardening after the OPEC meeting, and that can have a big impact because of the sheer importance of the oil subsidy part and the impact that it has on the budget. So I'd say that that's one warning signal, but it's not in the government's control. The international oil price. Right now, I would say that if I'm not personally that concerned about the 3.2 going wildly offline or something. These numbers are expected. It's because mainly the front loading of expenditure which took place. And now what will happen with the extra spending they're promising? They of course taken care of the recapitalization bonds by not putting it as a draft on the budget, but doing it as recapitalization bonds, which will actually be bought by the banks themselves. And only the small amount of interest burden will be a charge. I wouldn't worry too much about the fiscal deficit.
Nothing to worry about at the moment is what you're suggesting. And the trends, if you look at the August figures and September figures, seem to be going in that direction. Subhomoy Bhattacharya, as far as the August figures were concerned, I think the fiscal deficit has improved from 96% in August to about 91% now in September. What has contributed to that?
Partially, as Dr. Desai mentioned, what's happening is that the revenues is now kicking in. Revenues always come in towards the end of the year because that's when the mobilization starts. If you look at the income tax revenue, the first installment and the second installment is much less than the third and the fourth. And the government is obviously will be expecting the third installment to come in. Now, luckily for them, the numbers would have started improving, because if you look at the corporate scorecard, you would see more companies in this quarter showing larger profits over the corresponding period of last year. So correspondingly, they would be making larger allocation for income tax. So, and that's a very big chunk of the total tax revenue. So that's coming in. Second thing is that the GST numbers are not really out of whack. They may not be exceeding expectations, but they are actually not underperforming massively. So it's a zone of comfort for the government. So essentially, on revenue numbers, it's looking comfortable. Expenditure has already, large amount of the expenditure now goes to the states, and that has already been given out in the beginning of the year. So the center doesn't need to make provision for any major expenditure at the end of this year. There are no natural calamities that is asking for government handout. It's been a comfortable year for monsoon, excepting some areas where, so there's no huge need to any spending. So expenditure is basically being paid out and isn't coming immediately on Mr. Jaitley's book to say that, you know, you need to make this huge allocation. So essentially, on tax revenue is comfortable. The only worry, as Desai pointed out, is the non-tax revenue. But disinvestment, for the first time after, say, 8 years, will be more than 75,000 crore, and that's a solid amount. The worry is that the RBI number, the RBI dividend, which had been factored in earlier, I mean, had factored in at a higher level, isn't going to come at that level. So that is the gap that the government will need to make up.
Sure.
But, you know, a difference of 20,000 crore or so on a budget of 20 lakh crore isn't really something which a finance minister won't be able to bridge through.
Sure. You know, does this mean going forward that the government and the RBI will have some fiscal room to come out with some big ticket decisions?
Yes, I would, and it's certainly one big ticket decision has been taken, which was on the infrastructure thing that they've announced. And quite frankly, as an economist, my thing would be the priority of the government should be to stimulate investment, particularly in the household sector. If you look at the numbers over the past 5 years, the corporate sector investment share as a part of GDP has remained around 11%, a bit here, bit down, bit up, bit down. The public sector's investment as a proportion of GDP has also remained around 7% plus minus. The big drop is in household investment, from 15% 5 years ago to 10% now. And I think this is what they should start addressing, because that's really where a lot of job generation also takes place. And a lot of demand generation takes place. If those guys start investing, building, and it'll all be in a lot of tier two, tier three type of towns, then that also generates demand. So my advice today would be, focus on stimulating the economy. You don't have to break the fiscal deficit, but there are many things you can do. And the key lies in doing something to stimulate the small sector, which has been badly hit by demonetization and GST implementation. So this is the thing. There is room. There is room for taking a few chances. The only thing I would watch out for is the international oil price.
Okay, watch out for the international oil prices, and there is room to do quite a bit as far as the small sector is what you're suggesting at this point in time.
Well, focus on the small sector.
Focus on the small sector. Dhirendra Kumar, you know, as far as some of the sectors are concerned, you know, what are the sectors that have been doing well, and what are the sectors that you expect to do well in the near future?
Sectors doing well, in fact, across the board. You know, we see improvement in the sectors which were struggling. And we see a clear discrimination between the companies which were doing well, are doing exceptionally well, and the struggling company, they are trying to wriggle themselves out of trouble. So we find that, you know, I don't think there's any, of course, you know, from a stock market perspective, we clearly find the changing preferences of the fund manager or the market, and clearly technology and pharma is completely out of favor for a variety of other reasons than the government. But that part, I think, you know, we have clear winners and losers, and I find that, you know, the kind of optimism shown by the, of course, one is optimism, and of investors, the pouring money. For the first time ever, we have seen in a struggling economy, we have the stock market going up purely on optimism without sound numbers, without rising earnings. But at the same time, the earnings are not something to be, you know, there is nothing alarming about that. And we see clear improvement in many companies. in most of the companies. In fact, the troubled companies are trying to wriggle themselves out of trouble. And looks like, you know, there is reason to be hopeful with many of them. I think the real estate sector, what Dr. Desai was saying, is that stimulating growth, getting back and broad-basing the whole growth story. I think this banking sector, the plan of action, I think it will take some time to pan out, to, you know, and you know, have an impact in the marketplace, credit growth and driving that, and also to some extent simplification of the GST, because GST, despite being rolled out on a massive scale and a big change, I think it is way off from being anything simple which people can embrace, and that's a huge speed breaker for the small sector to embrace, and you know, it is not a confidence inspiring thing at all.
Okay, you know, this is something that you two raised, Subhomoy, in your opening remarks about the GST, talking about how, yes, there are teething problems. We all knew that there would be teething problems for the first 1 year or so after GST was rolled out. But you said that the impact has not been too high as far as the fiscal health is concerned. Do you see that being a problem going ahead?
No, it won't be. In fact, as the people get accustomed to GST, you see the numbers improving. It's already started to, because people do realize that there's no question of any rollback. So GST is there. They have to make use of the available opportunities and fit their business accordingly. So I don't really expect GST numbers, and wherever they are, they'll only improve from here on. Remember, the GST numbers have also been clouded by the fact that the government has deferred implementation, in the sense like filing of returns. Mm. Even in terms of filing their tax data. Now, that is basically bunching it towards the end of the year. So there would be a spike towards the end of the year, which would happen. So GST is, I think, fairly safe for the moment. The interesting thing is that what's happening in the government treasury is that, you know, having done GST, having done expenditure going along to the states, the center's room for bringing in surprises is becoming quite limited. So when we say growth stimulus, frankly speaking, there are not too many things, floating cards, which Mr. Jaitley can really bring in. And that is something, then that's a straitjacket that will be on display more and more for the government of India in the years going ahead. Now, is that bad? I wouldn't say it's bad, because if you look at the ease of doing business report, what it does show is that a predictable and a stable system gives the country much better marks than a government which is good intentioned but keeps on changing goalposts. So there is a lot to be said for predictability, smoothness, regularity. GST by itself is something that would take time for people to spread out. You can't bring in, you know, just because it looks good, you can't bring in radical changes overnight that actually makes others willing to game the system. So there are these things that are happening in this economy. So at this time, as again, Desai pointed out, yes, one missing link is the household saving. If that comes back into the picture, there would be a lot of changes that one can expect. But beyond that, from the government's own wherewithal to carry out anything remarkably, something which will actually make the markets move, is something that's not on the cards. They've already played their big cards.
The big cards have been played. GST. There's only that much that the government can do at this Absolutely. Point in time, is what you're suggesting. You know, does that mean, Dr. Desai, that the worst is over for the Indian economy and it's only going to go up now?
Don't ask your forecast. Carl Brace said that you know, it's economic forecasts are meant to make astrological predictions look good. So I'm not going to make any forecast.
No, but is the worst over for the economy?
I don't know. I don't know. What I would say is, I wrote a piece just last week in his paper where I actually, echo his view, I ended up by this. I happened to be written on what is the Gujarati New Year's Day. So I said, I wished everybody a predictable New Year with fewer policy thunderbolts. So I think that's one hope. But leave that to one side. I'd say that let's see what happened in the second quarter. And what I've said is that if the second quarter number is below 6%, worry, and worry hard. If it's between 6 and 7, you can you're probably doing well. And if it is significantly above 7, then you're well on the way to recovery. So let's wait and see. The early signs from company reports and so on are reasonably promising, you know, some of the early signs that we had from the second quarter reports. But let us see and wait and see. I won't go into this business of is it good or bad. But, you know, let's ask what can we do?
Yes.
One of the key areas I still think is there is still scope for GST simplification. Yesterday, I was talking to a businessman, day before yesterday, I was talking to a small businessman. What he said is that I used to employ one accountant for 20,000 rupees a month to do my work. Now, with GST, I have to employ a second man, again for 20,000. And for the three invoices that I have to upload per month, I pay an additional 10,000. So my cost there has gone up from 20 to 50,000.
Yeah.
But also whether the people are available to do all this, you know, in the smaller places. So I think there's still scope for, I'm not saying abandon this business of matching of invoices and everything. Do it. But don't worry about it right now. If relaxation means that some parts of it will still be on an old-fashioned system of return filing and so on, and bring it in gradually over 2-3 years or something. So I'd say that these are some of the things which can help these people. Second, a lot of the small industries have shut down for quite some time. Hmm. This is where the banking sector can help in getting those people back on the ground. It doesn't have to be the government, but the banking system can help by getting those small guys back on their feet who have been basically really reeling for the past, at least for more than 6 months now. And many of them have been shut. So get them back on track. So there are things that they can do. And remember this, that household investment can be relatively quick in its impact because a lot of it is in construction.
Yeah.
The big chunk of household investment is in construction. And that can be something which can be taken up very fast. It'll show up first in the things for steel, cement, but it'll also show up in the demand for labor, construction labor, etc., other services, and it will help to stimulate the process. So there are things which can be done without having to spend large sums of money. But let's see when it happens.
Okay, let's see when it happens. And I'm not going to ask you to play soothsayer for the time being, at least. Let's move on now. And, Dhirendra Kumar, Subhomoy Bhattacharya brought up the issue of ease of doing business. What has the reaction to the World Bank's report been thus far? How have the markets reacted? And can we expect something positive to come out of it?
Oh, undoubtedly, this is a big thing. But this is basically a report card. We have been witness to all this for a while now. Ever since the new government came in, we know that oil regulation changed overnight without much fanfare, and that has actually taken off a big potential contingent liability from the government. So that is one. If you look at all the small things which may not have a huge financial implication or which may not have a fiscal impact. But look at the Udaan thing or, the coal crisis that we witnessed 4 years ago. Today, it looks like there's a problem of plenty. Look at the big infrastructure projects. So government is doing it with. And I don't think, we needed, of course, it gets quantified and you get a relative ranking. So that might be encouraging. But we know that, this is a business-like government which has gone about fixing small problem, big problem, and taken its own time to do it right. That part, I think, the big piece which is still left, of course, some step has been taken, the Real Estate Regulation Act. But I think fixing the huge stuck projects, that has turned out to be a big dampener on the economy. And that is primarily because of, the greedy builders mismanaging their business. And, resolving those issues, that will also reasonably solve the bank's problem. And that requires a task force because this is concentrated in about 10 cities. The scale of project, and this is hugely, confidence destroyer for customers, for home buyers. The money is stuck. The projects are not complete. They are way off from completion. And that has caused all the kind of deceleration in the employment that could have been provided. And banks are stuck. So, the kind of impact that it can have, need for a task force to solve these. And these are not, this cannot be done with a regulation. This has to be done by a task force on a statewide project to project basis, resolving it, tying up bank, or you know, government playing a catalytic role, not a bailout, because this is where, you know, this is a huge impediment to a potential employment generating activity which has got stuck and looks unlikely to really, you know, reactivate itself.
Okay. You know, Dhirendra Kumar is suggesting that, you know, no more bailouts. Have we had quite a few of them? You know, as far as the farmer crisis was concerned, we saw that the government has announced a stimulus package for the farmers. You know, stimulus packages here and there. There was a recent stimulus package as well. Is it time to do away with the stimulus package module going ahead?
Yeah, and I think it has already been accepted. I mean, the finance minister has been clear that he's not talking in terms of stimulus. He's made it extremely clear that he will stick to the fiscal deficit within the limits. So there's not going to be any stimulus package. Real estate sector, what Dhirendra says is interesting, but you know, my problem there is that the ethics of the sector isn't particularly strong as far as the residential sector is concerned, even in commercial. And any task force, anything that we do, would essentially be faced with demand to give some or other relaxation. And we know that Indian government historically, not just this government, any government, hasn't been particularly good at working out, you know, these inter-say problems in terms of deciding whose claim merits recognition, whose doesn't. So there is again the problem of playing favorites. It's a huge problem, I recognize. I mean, there are people all around us who have invested massive amount of money in the real estate sector and their investments are stuck. But I mean, as of now, it doesn't seem to me a very great opportunity to give them a bailout, especially when there's, you know, the regulatory structure is not yet been set up. And in fact, some of the developers are still gaming the system by delaying the development of the RERA. For instance, Haryana has still not got a full RERA, and that's one should have been one of the first states that should have got it into place.
Sure. You know, let's look ahead now, Mr. Desai. Investment continues to be a problem. Domestic investment has not picked up at all over the last few quarters we've seen.
Yeah,
for a long time now, in fact. You know, so what needs to be done really as far as investment is concerned? Do you see it picking up?
I would say it'll start picking up only when industry starts seeing demand growth. Just asking them to invest more is not going to work. They have to see demand growth down the line. And I think the government should have a very identified one. I think, in a sense, we are right to pick on the real estate sector as one of the major areas of problems. I would argue that here, part of the problem is we did not sufficiently address the problem of home buyers. RERA does, but that's for the future. Today, what has happened is a lot of people who had put money with these builders to buy a flat have found finding that their money may be gone. Because under the law, the insolvency law, they are unsecured creditors.
Yes.
So they have no rights. Not so really, for all practical purposes. And now I think we should have addressed that issue a little earlier. I understand there's some move to address it, but we should have addressed it earlier because it has driven people away. In fact, part of the reason you're getting so many SIPs now, you know, the SIPs are basically investment by people who are not market players, but
yes,
who are savers, you know, who are saving for long term. They are the guys who do. And SIPs have been shooting up. I'm sure Dhirendra can confirm that. So I'd say that there are positive signs of savings coming up, financial savings coming up from younger people working in salaried jobs. But the sort of things that was there when people were trying to buy flats, etc., is not happening. But everybody is scared.
Yeah.
RERA is not giving comfort as yet to people. And you can talk to anybody and say, no, don't put any money into a flat. See what happened in this case and see what happened in that case. So I'd say there are things that the government can do which will open up the market a little. And my focus today would be on addressing the problems that home buyers today have.
Okay, fair enough. All right, time to get closing comments from all my guests now, beginning with Dhirendra Kumar. Looking ahead, you know, what's the way forward, really?
No, I think we have every reason to be optimistic. I don't want to hazard a guess. But everything on all parameter, I think it's very confidence inspiring. Small businesses need to worry. because the whole, you know, the GST is definitely tilting things to larger organized businesses. And every reason to be optimistic, going by all the things that have happened with this government in the last 3.5 years, small things being, you know, solved and being thought through in great detail with some kind of incentive or no incentive, but fixing a problem in a fairly involved way, fairly hands-on government. So that is quite inspiring.
Okay, Subhomoy?
Well, I would say that this year is already something on which the major cards, as I said, has been played. So the government should actually start looking at what to do for the year next. The budget is just around the corner. So now when they start writing the budget, they should have a plan for 2018-19 and some very good plans, because that is what the markets and everybody would be looking for. And if there are some forward-looking statements saying that this would be done next year, I think that would act as a stimulant, even if there's no money right on the table immediately.
What should the focus areas be, would you think?
Construction, obviously. I mean, we've all agreed. But construction doesn't, not just buildings, but roads, highways. So there's a major construction deficit that Indian economy is facing.
Can we say infrastructure then?
Infrastructure, basically constructing. Okay. That is where the main game would be.
Dr. Desai, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Well, what I would say is, I mean, you were asking, Dhirendra was very optimistic, and I was, if I may paraphrase Voltaire. Voltaire said that optimist is somebody who believes that we live in the best of all possible worlds. And a pessimist is somebody who's afraid that that is in fact the case. See, so let's leave it at that and let's wait. I think things are in a sort of limbo. A lot depends on how things happen. There are some plus signs, the export growth, for instance, picking up, some recent numbers which have come out on production, some company results which look very promising. So I'd say that there are green shoots, but I would still wait for a little while before I come to the conclusion, because I still think the small industry sector has not picked up.
Okay.
It has not yet picked up.
So that should be the focus area going forward, is what you're saying.
I would argue that, and then I think you'll probably find that the whole thing will take off.
Okay, all right. On that note then, we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Dhirendra Kumar, Subhomoy Bhattacharya, Nitin Desai, thank you so much for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have today. See you again next time.